If you're not saving your user's game in the cloud, I can guarantee you are losing players anytime they get a new device, because no matter how awesome your game is, and I'm sure it is, nobody wants to start all over again from level one when they reinstall it. I'm Todd Kerpelman, and while there are many cloud save solutions out there, the one I'm here to talk to you about today is the one you get for free with Google Play Game Services. So the Play Games team has upgraded their old cloud save feature in a major way. Heck, it's such a big update, we have renamed this feature from cloud save to saved games in the cloud. And we got a fancy new icon to go with it, huh? It's got an arrow in it and everything. But it doesn't just have a new icon. This new save game feature includes a bunch of improvements over the old cloud save. The biggest of which is that you can now save blobs of data up to 3 meg large. That is a lot of game data. And while you were limited to 4 slots earlier, now you can have as many as you want. Your app will now have a saved games badge in the Play Store, so everybody will know that they can save their progress as they're playing. You can also add metadata to your save game, like a description and a cover image, all of which will make your save games show up very nicely in the Play Games app or within your own game. I mean, look at that beautiful save game. Don't you want to click on it? I know I do. You know, players see this in the Play Games app, they're reminded, oh yeah, I was at this level, I had just gotten this cool new sword, I'm going to keep playing from where I left off. So these features are great, but along with these new features comes a new way of handling this save game data and new ways of managing conflicts. And I always find that when dealing with this stuff, particularly when it comes to debugging, it's best to have a decent understanding of how things work under the hood instead of it being some mystery black box. So let's take a peek behind the scenes here. You just might learn something. So the first thing you need to understand is that save games are represented internally as an object we call a snapshot. The snapshot contains the metadata, including things like the description of a file, a cover image, the amount of time you've played, and a local timestamp, as well as the giant blob of save game data. Save games are powered by Google Drive, and when you're storing or loading these save games to the cloud, the best way to picture what's going on is that somewhere in the user's Google Drive account, there is a hidden folder just for your application where this snapshot is being stored. And as these snapshots are being saved inside the folder, they're given a name just like any other file. And just like in a normal file, these names are the primary way we identify these snapshots to your application. Your user, however, never sees this name. They'll see your snapshot's description, cover image, and maybe some other metadata, but this name is never surfaced to them. It's really just an identifier for your application to use. Now, you can query and examine any of the metadata whenever you'd like. But it's important to know that to read the saved data or to write to it, even if you're writing to a brand new snapshot, you must open the snapshot first. Again, I guess it's kind of analogous to accessing local files in a language like, say, Python, right? You can find out the last modified time of a file, but if you want to read or write to it, you're going to need to call open on it to get the file handle. Now, most of this time, this open command, it's not very exciting. What's happening behind the scenes is that your device is downloading all this game data associated with your snapshot metadata, if it hasn't done so yet, and then tells your game when it's done. But this command does get complicated when we handle conflicts, so stay tuned. Now with that in mind, let's look at a simple situation where we're going to load an existing save game from the cloud, make some changes, and then save it again. Loading or opening a save game starts by opening up the snapshot as identified by its name. Now, if you're only ever dealing with a single save game that you're going to be saving and loading, you could get away with hard-coding this file name as a constant somewhere. Remember, these save games are being saved in the user's Drive account in a folder that is reserved just for your application. So you don't need to worry about making these file names unique. You don't have to call it, you know, com.example.myapp.savegame.userid. You could just call it something as unoriginal as, like, save game, or, I don't know, Dan, I guess. In Android Java land, loading and opening a snapshot is accomplished using the games.snapshots.open method. In the iOS world, you're going to be using the open with file name conflict policy completion handler method, and in the C++ world, you're going to be using the snapshot manager's open command. The implementations do vary slightly, but you'll notice that in all cases, you provide a name of the snapshot, and by the end of the process, you're left with a snapshot that has been opened and is now available for reading or writing. Reading the contents of a snapshot is accomplished by calling a second command on the open snapshot or snapshot metadata object. In Android land, this is read fully. In iOS, it's read with completion handler. And in C++, it's read or read blocking. Again, this is a separate command because while we can load the snapshot data into memory right away, we probably don't want to have to do this for a 3 meg chunk of game data until we really have to. And in all cases, you're going to get back a byte array, some NS data, or a byte vector that you can then pass along to your game and process as necessary. Now let's say that we've gone and opened your snapshot and read in some data and passed it along to our game, and now the player has made some progress and wants to save their game. To do this in Android, you're going to need to write this game data back onto the same snapshot you opened earlier. You're not going to be creating a new one. What you are going to do is create a new snapshot metadata change object. So let's ignore this, the rest of this snapshot here, and just look at this new object. The metadata change object is basically a list of elements in the metadata, such as a description, time plate, or cover image, that are different between this version of the snapshot and what was up there before. Basically, the Save Game API will look at this change object and kind of overlay it on top of your old metadata to create this new metadata object. Once you've done this, you'll call commit and close on Android devices, where you'll pass in the old snapshot with the new data and the metadata change object, right there. On iOS and C++, it's slightly different in that you do create a new game data object instead of writing over the old one, but you're still creating a metadata change object as well. And then all that gets sent up. You'll take the current snapshot metadata and call a commit method on it. You'll do something similar in C++. And in both cases, you can see we have our currently open snapshot, our metadata change object, and our new data. Once you've committed all this information and once you've saved all this information and committed your snapshot, it is now considered closed. And you'll want to reopen it again if you want to write more data to it. So easy peasy, right? Okay, so let's look at some situations where things can get a little funky. What do you do if this is a brand new player or somebody who's never signed into game services before and they try to open a save game file that doesn't exist? Actually, this isn't really a problem. On Android, one of the arguments you pass to snapshots.open is a create if not found boolean. Set this to true and you're all set. You simply open up a snapshot with no data in it. In iOS and C++, you don't even need to do that. It'll create an empty file by default. Then you simply treat this empty snapshot like any other snapshot. It's just one that has no data and all of its metadata is set to default values and or null, or I guess nil on iOS. Simply by updating this snapshot with your first set of game data and a reasonable metadata change object, you can get this looking like a real snapshot in no time. So up until now, we've talked as though you're just loading and saving the same game file over and over again. But let's say you want to manage more than one save game file. How do you do that? Well, for starters, you're not going to be hard coding your snapshot name. You're going to need to figure out which snapshot to save and load at runtime. And to do that, you're going to need to give the player the ability to pick which save game they want to use, create a save game, and so on. Luckily, the UI to handle all this is provided for you by the game services libraries. When you want to present a user with a list of save games, you can call up our UI. Now, there are several settings you can tweak with this UI, either as parameters in Android and C++ or as delegate methods in Objective-C. These settings will let you decide how many save games to show in this UI, whether or not to give the user the ability to delete a save game, and most importantly, whether or not the user has the ability to create a new save. Now, if I'm a user and I click one of these existing saves, it'll hit a callback in your game, and in that callback, you'll get back the name of the snapshot to open. You can now just use this name to open up the correct snapshot, just like before, and you're ready to go. But let's say I'm a user and I want to create a new save game. I would click the Save New Game button, and your app then gets a callback that this button was clicked. At this point, it's up to you to basically create a new snapshot by asking to open a saved game with a name that does not exist yet. So how do you decide what to name it? It's kind of up to you. You could use a timestamp, that's pretty good. You could use a random number appended to a timestamp, I guess that's even better. You could query the names of all the other snapshots, examine them all, and then increment a number for the new one, that'd work too. The only trick is that it needs to be unique for this particular player. Doesn't need to be all that memorable since, as you just saw, you're always going to get that file name from the UI that our library provides. It will never be surfaced to the user. They're never going to need to refer to it by name. However you do it, as soon as you request a snapshot with a file name that doesn't exist yet, you get back an empty snapshot that you can then use as your new game. Keep in mind that the intended flow for all this is like what you might see at the beginning of a console game, right? I'm at the main menu, I want to start a game, and the game lets me pick from, you know, continuing from a previously saved slot or, you know, starting a completely new game. It's not really intended to say let the user switch save game slots mid-game or duplicate their progress or anything like that. I mean, I suppose you could hack it to work that way, but it's going to feel a little clunky. So, okay, you gotten this far? Give yourself a pat in the back because you have completed level one. Okay, stop padding, because this is all good background, but the real test comes when you need to start detecting and resolving snapshot conflicts. And for that, you're just going to need to watch our next video. Hopefully this link will be live by the time you're watching this, but if not, check back soon, because it will be. So thanks for watching, gang. Feel free to follow me on G+ or Twitter, and I will see you soon for part 2, our exciting conclusion. Dun, dun, dun.